Mama, I scream as I sit up in bed, my heart pounding. I force my eyes open, blink. I wipe away the sleepy ooze from my tawny lashes and realize it has been 7 months exactly since the cancer defeated her. I haven't been by your house, Mama, since it sold. I don't know if I'll ever go back. I think you'd like the lady who bought it, though. I hope she'll take care of it. The nightstand clock reads 9:30. Honey, my mixed with who knows what chihuahua, had performed her Cirque du Soleil acrobatics against the side of my bed to rouse me and is now exhibiting her ritualistic boot scooting, producing a snail-like trail of tiny beige hairs to linger until the next round of vacuuming. Meanwhile, Willie, my tender-hearted, scruffy-whiskered, black-and-white half-breed terrier who moves a tad on the cranky side prior to his ceremonial neck-extending stretch, needs to relieve himself. Groggy from sleep, I drag my body from bed and stagger into the hall. Aware that the insanely torrid temperatures are rising, I shudder at the thought of opening the door. Guys, I'm hurrying, bless your heart. Stepping onto the wooden deck, Little Rock's summertime slaps me in the face. It may hit 108 degrees today, kids. The air is like wet, dirty socks. Local weathermen predict our fair city will experience an unusually long heat wave. Record-breaking, stifling high temperatures and oppressive humidity are in store. I feel perspiration gathering in every crook, crack, and cranny of my body. It is difficult to breathe. I think to myself, your frail, diseased lungs wouldn't tolerate this miserable heat, Mama. I miss you, but I'm glad you're not here. Gangs of blue jays squawk and crows caw, waiting for their special breakfast, torn up pieces of white bread. The songbirds flit about the hanging bird feeders as they nab safflower and sunflower seeds. Ruby-throated hummingbirds dart through the thick and heavy morning air, punch drunk on sugar water. A rogue member of the band of cottontail rabbits lazily lounges under the weathered bench, sprawled on her side, white downy belly exposed, posing for the centerfold in Play Bunny. A chipmunk darts past me, vaulting himself not onto the rim of the nearest concrete birdbath, but up onto the edge of the Arlington, the outlying and secluded copper-rinsing district where he sips the tepid water. Gray squirrels bark at each other as they scurry up and down the hickories and pines, and my lone, distinguished red squirrel bolts out from beneath the cedar, fluffy, rust-colored tail jerking. I sigh. Peace surrounds me. However, in the blink of an eye, the moment vanishes. I clumsily reach for my favorite chair's armrest and sink down into the weaved nylon. Unable to stop the tears streaming down my puffy cheeks, I squeeze my eyes shut. Mama, why can't I be happy? I raise my throbbing head and look upward, yearning for an angel to peer from above, then whisper aloud, this pain, will I never be allowed to heal? Then I hear her. No, it isn't my mother's voice. I hear a bird, the bird. She's up in the trees. I search for her distinct crisp markings, crimson hood, soft snowy breast, and striking plumage contrasts. strokes of wet liquid paper on an opulent coating of ebony, visible on her tuxedo accoutrement of wings and tail feathers. While the waxy oak leaves and the blinding angle of the sun's rays concealed her whereabouts, she continued making the sound, her sound, the trill of a single brand new playing card firmly clothespinned to a spinning bicycle spoke. I expected her to swoop down from a branch, perch on the farthest feeder in the backyard, and retrieve her favorite seed and lard-filled suet. Yet today, she shielded herself from my view and talked. What I heard was what I needed to. Marianne, don't be sad. We may no longer be with you, but you are not alone. You, our only child, are part of us, and we are part of you that cannot change. Daddy and I live on in your memories. Every morning when you wake up, every night before you fall asleep, you'll feel us. When the wind brushes your cheeks, it is our hands that caress your skin. You will sense our presence whenever you're uneasy or scared. Even your childlike giggling will remind you of the laughter, the love we shared as a family, and this will forever provide you strength. When your time comes, the three of us will be together. But live your life first. It was a spellbinding moment hearing my mother's words in the woodpecker's trilling. Suddenly, the solution became undeniably clear. In order to move on with life, it would be up to me to get through this last stage of grief and restore my spirit. I want to live, I shouted. Willie and Honey stopped their sniffing and stood at a standstill in the yard, checking to make sure I was all right. I'm fine, you two. Everything's okay, I promise. Then my mind took off like an Indy roadster. Mama, ever since Daddy's death, you told me that you dreaded this day. I dreaded it too. The day that I would be all alone. Well, this day is here, and it's worse than I ever thought it could be. After Daddy died, our lives were never the same. For years, you know this to be true, we both stopped living. When you passed away, I became completely lost. I've been lost ever since. You're gone, Mama. You're gone. How do I start to live? On cue, the red-headed woodpecker glided in for a landing, seized several hunks of soot, and then took off again. As I watched this majestic bird ascend into the cloudless blue, I smiled because I knew, I can't explain how, through this regal creature, Mama had just given me her blessing to be happy. Thank you, Mama.